Hello, we are now presently studying the global positioning system. As you might have already studied or gone through the theoretical part, now I will be covering the practical part of the global positioning system. In your practical, there are three exercises. One exercise is on handheld GPS, a demonstration on handheld GPS, and the exercise which is for half an hour. And the exercise 2 is on differential global positioning system data collection, which is also for half an hour. And there is another slot of 30 minutes for on mobile mapping and location based services. Okay, now today we'll start with the differential GPS data collection. Before going to the field, I would like to just brief about what all the things we are going to do on the field and how we are going to proceed in the field. Okay, now we are trying to understand how to perform the global positioning system survey. Okay, so from the theoretical background, you might have now understood that receiver receives the signal from the GPS satellites which are orbiting around the earth at about 22,000 kilometers. And you also understand that you need to have the signals from minimum of 4 satellites, right? So that means to say that if you want to know the position of this point on the ground, you need to place a receiver over that point and try to get the signals from the minimum of 4 satellites. So these satellites basically transmit the signal, and the receiver collects the signals, right? And upon analyzing, the receiver will be able to produce the location of this point. Okay, the location is given in terms of either x, y, z, or in terms of latitude, longitude, and elevation. Okay, and also you understand from the theoretical background that these coordinates are in WGS 84, which is nothing but world geodetic system. Continue. Okay, so we get the position in WGS 84, which is nothing but the world geodetic system, which was established in 1984. Okay, so this kind of positioning we call it as the standalone. In standalone mode. Okay, so however you get the position, but this position has got some errors. Okay, so these errors will make the positional accuracy to few meters. Okay, so now our aim is to improve this accuracy. How to improve the accuracy? Okay, so for that what we do is we go for another kind of surveying that we call it as differential global positioning system survey. In this we say, suppose this is your field where you want to know the position of this point, right, with an accuracy of few centimeters. Okay, right, so for that what we do is we take a point, right, we take a point on the ground surface whose x, y, z or latitude, longitude and elevation are already known to best accuracies. Okay, so then we place a receiver here and we place a receiver
here. Okay, so this point we call it as base, and this receiver we call it as rover. Okay, and the vectorial line joining this base and rover is called as baseline. Okay, so now our aim is to know this location to the best accuracies. Okay, so let me redraw this figure. So in DGPS, as we understand till now, we place a receiver on a known point that we call it as the base. Okay, and here is a point whose position is not known. Okay, so you place a receiver here, right? So these receivers will be continuously getting, say there are satellites orbiting, so these are the satellites orbiting around the Earth. So let me write it as, say, satellite number 25, satellite okay, so this satellite will be getting the signal, this rover will be getting the signal from it tracks the signals from all the visible satellites, right? And it computes, say this is your known position, but apart from that, from this 4 satellites, this receiver can compute the XYZ. Let me call it as the computed. Okay, now at the base you have 2 coordinates for the same point, right? One coordinate was which was known earlier with an accuracy of, say, higher accuracies. Okay, now this is the XYZ of the same point, but computed from GPS satellites. Okay, these coordinates you can get it from benchmarks, or from the topo sheets, etc. Okay, yeah, so similarly at the rover end, rover also tracks the satellites. So from this 5 satellites, the rover computes the X, Y and Z, right? So let me write it as XR, YR and ZR. This is basically to represent the position of the rover. So let me write it here as the B as a subscript, and overall bracket I'll write it as C here, basically because this is computed, and let me write it as K. This is the known coordinates. Okay, now our aim, now this coordinates will have an accuracy to few meters. Okay, now the accuracy, right? So this accuracy we have to bring it down to few centimeters. That is the aim of the present practical exercise. Okay, the question is how to get this. So yes, the question is how to improve the accuracy, right? In order to improve the accuracy, you need to bring down the errors to zero or as less as possible, right? So this position, it has got, let me write it as So the accurate value of the rover plus the errors will be computed when you get the signals from the satellite and you compute the position, right? So here our task would be to reduce this errors, right? So you might have understood from the theoretical background what are the different kinds of error that you come across, right? So we need to minimize this. How to minimize this? The one approach is that you take the known position of the base, computed position of the base from the satellites, and try to get the difference of this. Okay, once you take this difference is nothing but x, y, and z of this base which is known, right, minus x b y b z b which is computed from the satellites. Okay, right, so this is nothing but the error which I am talking of, right? These errors, if you look, then the total error budget is due to the different components, which I can break it down this way, right? The errors can be due to the ionosphere, the error can be due to the multipath, the error can be due to the satellite clock, or the error can be due to the receiver clock. So there are n number of reasons for getting this. Now our aim would be to bring down these errors. So now here I am just talking of the error in a very generalized sense. Okay, now I know this, how much is the error from the base, and if I apply this correction, this error I can call it as the corrections also, right? So this error or correction will be applied at the rover, right? So once you apply, then from this computed you get the XR, YR and ZR which are accurate to few centimeters. Okay, so here the job of the base is to send the corrections to the base or compute the errors or compute the corrections, and then these corrections will be applied to the rover. Okay, so once those applied, then you get the position of the rover to an accuracy of to few centimeters or to the sub centimeters. Okay, so this is the basic philosophy behind the DGPS, right? So further talking more about the differential GPS, right, this can be done in two modes, right? One mode is we call it as real time, and the second one is the post processing. Okay, so in real time, so by this time you understand that you need to place a receiver over a base and a receiver over a rover whose position is not known, and here we know the position of the base. Okay, in case of, now we are talking of the real time. In real time, the base from the four satellites compute, this is the known. Okay, these satellites, they compute the XYZ. Okay, so the difference gives you the correction, and these corrections will be applied to the rover in real time. Okay, so for this, in order to apply the corrections in real time, along with the base, you need to have a modem which can transmit the corrections from base to the rover, and a rover need to have a separate antenna for corrections. So this modem will transmit the correction and the antenna will receive these corrections. Okay, and these corrections will be applied so that the XYZ at rover, now these XYZ are the computed XYZ from the satellite, so these corrections will be applied to this, right? Further, then you get the XYZ in centimeter level of accuracy. Okay, so this is the basic thing required for the real time DGPS, differential GPS. Okay, and regarding the post processing method, just place a receiver over base, okay, and start the survey. Okay, further, when we go on to the field, we will see how the settings or how to start this survey. Okay, now over the base, so this base will get the signals from the satellites and it will store it in a file inside the receiver, and okay, so say this is a point whose position we have to find it out, and let me call it as the rover, right? You place a receiver here. Okay, this receiver also gets the signal from the satellites. Okay, this will store it in a file. Let me call this as the F1 and this is F2. Okay, so let us say that this is occupying for the time, say 10 o'clock to 11 o'clock time. For 1 hour you are occupying this particular point, right? And so if there are more points, then you need to place the receiver at different points. So this is a field. Okay, these positions are unknown, then you will be occupying the different points on the ground for different times, say 12 o'clock to 13 hours and 15 hours to 16 hours, something like that. So then the base also should be simultaneously getting the data. That means to say the base should be on from 10 o'clock to say 16 hours. So in order to apply this differential corrections, the base and the rover should be observing the satellites at the simultaneously. Okay, then these files F1, let me call it as F3 and F4, these will be stored in a rover. Okay, so after the survey is done, we go back to the office and we download this data, this F1, F3, F2, F4 into the system, okay, into the workstation. Okay, so using the software, processing software, these corrections which are computed will be applied to different points on the ground. Okay, once you apply the correction, then these positions will be accurate to few centimeters. So this is about how to do the differential GPS, both in kinematic and in real time and the post processing mode. Okay, we understand that for real time you need to have a modem at the base, and antenna at the rover, so that the when the modem sends the corrections, it can receive the rover can receive the corrections in real time. And in post-processing, you just place a rover at receiver at the base, and then start the survey, collect the file, okay. And in the base also in the rover, you collect the file, another file, and this file F2 and the data here at the base will be collected at the same time, and process these two files in a workstation using this post-processing softwares, right? Those softwares will apply the corrections from base to the rover, and that's how you get the very accurate position of the rover. Okay, so now we are at the base station, right? We'll be setting up the base here. Okay, so we have got a mark whose coordinates we have calculated with the help of the other surveying works to a higher accuracies. So here is the mark. Okay, so here you can see a plus mark here, right? So this plus mark has we know the coordinates of this plus mark to a very higher accuracies, right? Now we will be establishing a base station over this mark, right? For establishing the base station, we have the Leica instrument, right, which is okay. So for this differential positioning survey work, we have the Leica single frequency receiver, right? This is the receiver box, and in order to establish the base station, we have the tripod. This is a tripod. Okay, now we'll see the different components of this receiver. So this receiver system has got different components, as you see here. This is the antenna. Okay, and this is the receiver where the data will be stored, and this has got a monitor which can be detached. This monitor is basically to interact with this hardware, right? This can be placed it over here. Okay, and apart from this, there are some other accessories like the connections for the antenna and the receiver. This is the wire, and in order to connect the battery, there is another wire given here. And then there are some other accessories which provide the flexibility to place it over the tripod. Okay, so now we will be establishing the base station. That is, as we have already discussed, the basic operations at the base station will be centering, leveling, and then configuring the instrument. Right, now we will be centering and leveling the tripod rover. Okay, so now I am trying to establish a base station over the base point, right? For that, first the operation you have to do is the leveling, centering, and then configuring. So now I am trying to explain how to do the leveling. Okay, so just place this tripod over the base and try to adjust the height as you feel comfortable. So just by visual, you have to adjust this, you have to see that this plane is almost horizontal, right? Or else you can take the help of pen also, right? So take a pen which can roll and say place the pen here. So this will tell you where is the lower side. So now this pen is going this way, so I need to just adjust this way. So by this we have just done the coarse level of leveling, and then here is a dry batch, so which has got a spirit bubble. This bubble will help me in doing the fine leveling. Okay, so I'll be placing this it over here apartment.
Okay, so this tri-batch has got three screws which will help me in fine-tuning the leveling process. Okay, now you see the bubble here. Bubble dikhai. Right, so this bubble we have to bring it into this circle of this, inside the circle. Okay, for that I have to do the fine leveling. So I'll be doing it with the help of three screws. Okay, so for that you take any two screws and try to rotate it either inside or outside depending upon the movement of the bubble. Okay, so after fine tuning with these three screws, then I could successfully bring this bubble inside that circle, which tells me that the leveling of this instrument is done to a finer level. Okay, so after that I should also ensure that this instrument is placed exactly over the base station, right? That is nothing but the centering. For that there is an optical plumbet is given, right? From here I can see. Right. So if this tripod is not exactly over this, then I need to shift this tripod. Okay, so once I shift the tripod, the leveling again goes out of shape. So again I need to do this leveling process. So we understand that this centering and leveling is an iterative process. So band kar de. So after now we have done the centering and leveling part. After that now we will be mounting the antenna over this tri-batch. So for that there is an accessory called the antenna mount is given. So this is the antenna mount. So this is the antenna. So at the receiver you have got the different ports. So this port is for the antenna, this port is for the power, and this is the extra port, and these are the power ports. Okay, okay. So now I have attached the antenna with the receiver. Now we need to give the power support to the receiver. Okay, so this receiver has got a data card. So here the data will be stored in this PC card. Okay, so now We have done the basic operations, two of the basic operations, that is the centering, leveling and mounting the antenna, and then doing the connections between the different components. So now the receiver is ready for doing the configuration and starting the GPS survey. Okay, now we have to switch on this instrument. Either the switching on can be done from this or from here. So once you switch on, this is the welcome screen, and here you see the different options available for it. That here you see a person carrying a pole, and here it is showing you the number of satellites that will be visible, and here you will get the number of satellites that are transmitting or being tracked in L1 and L2 signals. Right, this is showing the PC card status, and here this is showing the battery status. Okay, so here there are different options to configure this instrument as per your requirements. Right, so in configuring and starting the survey, there are three things we have to do. For one is the configure the instrument. Right, this is configuration nothing but informing the instrument how it should function. Right, you have to just browse to that and press enter. So once you press enter, then the already present configurations will be present here. You can either continue with the present configuration, or you can make a new configuration, you can edit the configuration, you can delete the configuration, you can get the information from the configuration, and you can also search for the configuration using this button. Right, so these are the different options, and the just and the buttons just below this will facilitate you to access those options. Right, so here now we'll try to make a new configuration. So for that, this is the new, and you have to just press this button F2. So just press this button F2, it will ask you for the new configuration. So here it is asking me for the name, like I just give it as demo. Okay, here you can add some description about this configuration, and then you can also give the name of the creator. Right, and then just press on continue. Now it is asking me the mode in which it has to function. Right, so here there are two modes, one is the advanced mode and the another is the standard mode. Standard mode is nothing but this has got some of the default configurations. Okay, so generally we go with this advanced. Press on continue. Okay, now it is asking me the configuration for the antenna type. Right, so if here you see the antenna name, so the different options are available. So accordingly you have to choose the antenna that you are using. So the antenna that we are presently using is this AT501 tripod. Just select that antenna and then press on continue. Okay, then it will automatically take this vertical offset. So this here, the vertical offset for this antenna is 36 centimeters or 0.36 meter. Okay, now here we have to provide the antenna height. Right, say the here in our case the antenna height is 1.2. right, and what was the type of measurement this antenna height was measured. So in this you have both, one is the slope measurement and another is the vertical. So the measurement which I have done is the vertical. So in vertical the antenna height is 1.2 meters. Okay, just press on continue. Then it will ask for the position type, that is how much should be the update rate of the receiver. Right, you have to select here the different update rates. So here the update rates vary from 0.1 to 60 seconds. So generally we do for 1 second, and now it is asking me to configure for the coordinate system. So since no transformations have to be done, then I keep the coordinate system as the WS84 geodetic, and then press on continue. So now it is asking me the format of the data that it is going to provide me. So I can configure it as easting, northing and height, or northing, easting and height. So this just depends upon the ordering of the position. Okay, in case of latitude, longitude, then first will be the longitude, and then latitude, and then height. Okay, just press continue. Then it will ask for the real time. So as we have already discussed that in order to do the real-time survey, we need to have a modem at the base and a separate antenna to receive the corrections from modem at the rover. Since we do not have that setup, we have to go with this real time as none. Just press continue. Now it will ask for the logging. That is, logging is nothing but storing the data that is received at the antenna end for a given update ratio to be stored in a file, right? Yes, it is asking me for log static observation. Then here the options are yes or no. So since we are taking this observation in static, I have to go with this yes, and the observation rate is 1 second. Yes, and then log moving observations. If the antenna is moved, should that reading be recorded or not? So since it is a base, generally we go with this no. Okay, press continue. So it is just giving a warning that whenever the antenna is moved, either manually or due to the external forces, it will not be recording the readings. Okay, so just accept this warning. Then it will ask for the occupation settings, right? In this you have the occupancy mode. In this mode you have the instantaneous and normal mode, right? Instantaneous is nothing but whenever you just move and place it, then it will record, and in normal case it does as per our configuration. And the other is the auto stop, whether it should whether this receiver should stop automatically or it should be only in a manual mode. Since it is a base, I would prefer to have it in a non-auto mode, right? Just press on continue. And then the ID template is nothing but the point ID template in which it will be storing the points. Like here the occupied point will be stored with respect to the time and date. Similarly, you can select the different available templates or you can make your new template. And then press on continue. Then it will ask for the DOP limits. DOP is nothing but the dilution of precision, which you might have already studied in your theory discussions, right? So here you can set the different values. Like the default value here it is set as 20, so let us go with the 20, right? Disable height phase, yes. Since it is a static mode and it is also the base setup, generally we go with this height disable as fixed. Press on continue. Then it will ask for the offset, whether there is an offset or no, right? So since there is no offset, let us go with the configuration available. So now with that, we have done the configuration of the instrument, right? So the demo was the configuration. So we'll just go with it. Okay, so now we are done with the configuration. Now we just need to create a job file. So for that, just press the up arrow and then press on continue. Okay, after that, then these are all the jobs already done. If you want, you can create a new one. Enter, continue. Okay, continue. Okay, so and then you are also now done with creating a job file. After that, you have to go to the GIS data collection, press on continue. Okay, then it will automatically take the configuration as demo, job file as demo, the coordinate system is WGS geodetic, okay, and the antenna type is AT501 tripod. Okay, here you have to give the code port type. Since it is a base, we do not need to create a large code list, so I just go with the already present code, that is base. Okay, so now if you see here, by this time the satellites available are 8, but tracked are only 1 in L1. So we have to wait for minimum 4 number of satellites in order to occupy this point. Okay, so now you can observe here that the number of satellites that are available here are 8, and the satellites that are tracked are 8, right? And also you see after getting the minimum 4 number of satellites, you will get a precision mark, this plus mark, right? After getting this right precision mark, you have to just press on occupy, right? So once you occupy, you see there is a change in the symbol, right? So we have started this survey in a static mode, so you get a tripod symbol. Otherwise you have a person standing with a pole, right? So here, and if you want to stop the survey work, just you have to press this F1, which is just below the stop, right? So now we have started the base. So with this we have done all the procedures that are to be done for establishing a base station, right? So if you want to see some parameters, then you have to press on status. Once you press on status, you have different options. One is data logging,
data collection, logs, general and interfaces, right? So we'll go into the data collection. In that you will be able to see the real time, right? Since we are not doing the survey in real time, you will not be able to see any data. So I'll just try to show you the position here. Go to the option of position and then press on enter. Then you will be able to see the latitude, longitude and the height. And also you should remember that this height is nothing but the ellipsoidal height, but not the mean sea level height, right? So this is one. And if you want to see the number of satellites, you can see here, these are the satellite numbers 32, 31, 20, 16, 1 and 14, and these are their respective elevations and azimuths. And this SN1 is nothing but the signal to noise ratio of the signal L1 tracked. If it is able to track the L2 also, then you will get the SN2, which corresponds to the signal to noise ratio of the signal L2. And these are the quality parameter of that particular satellites.